partners, donation by private foundations and philanthropies, donation by private sector, it comes to almost 800 million that has gone to KEMSA.
It has gone to KEMSA in form of goods in kind.
Yes.
Like when the Jack Ma arrives, it is sent to KEMSA.
Yes.
From KEMSA, we will do the distribution. And by the way, Chair and Honorable Members, on donations, we have a 200-page document which we have sent in soft copy, showing all the donations and how they have been distributed. So you have it in soft copy.
So you've calculated now the even the goods and the items that came
in
into
kind.
Value, then you put it in cash.
In fact, it's written here, in kind, it is there. In kind. When it says in kind, it means you did not receive any money, you received goods.
For example, when you see Jack Ma there and you see Jack Ma to KEMSA, it simply means the reagents came. Where were they taken? They were either taken to KEMRI or they were taken to KEMSA. When you get PPEs from Chinese and they say they are making a donation, there is nowhere else to take them. We take them to KEMSA because that is where the storage facilities are. But you have to record where those things have gone. Otherwise, if you don't record, then how do you know that it is not Mutahi Kagwe?
No, Waziri,
in his house? Yeah?
Waziri, there is no problem about all this at all. But you see, it depends on how you frame it, how you table it. Because you see, if now pick it. And you know, Waziri, what, as a committee, we are working together. We are trying to unearth or perhaps maybe expose and differentiate between the truth and the myth that surrounds all these issues. And
can I please,
yes.
Honorable Member, clarify?
Yes.
If you look at Annex number 8, this is distributed to the fund from World Bank. And this, in fact, we are very clear. It's around the 5 billion. But you can see that the only items that have been procured and delivered is the ventilators, the vehicles for rapid response, some few medical equipment, and you can see how those are listed all the way down to the page, I think the third page. So that is really what we can say as far as that World Bank funding is concerned. The one for donations, Chair and Honorable Members, there's an attachment. What you have is a summary. There's an attachment that is a 200-page document because we have documented everything that we have received, and you have been seeing the ministry receiving these things in the media, and we have as well been sending distribution leads to KEMSA to do the delivery. So what you're seeing here is a highly summarized version of what it is that we have received, and we have tried to quantify and give some value around it based on the airway bill, the documents that accompany the cargo when it's coming into the country. And then to go now further to say, when it comes to the issue of what do we tell KEMSA what to do, I want to say very, very categorically, if you look at the way that these things are requisitioned. Number one, there are committees that sit. If you're talking about lab reagents and testing kits, you'll find a laboratory subcommittee which will sit, look at the machines that we have in this country, and make clear recommendation of the type of testing kit that we require. So there is no direction that we give on this matter except from what the committee has considered as the best testing kit. Let me also say that some of the testing kits we have received even on donation have not been very good. And the lab team are very quick to tell us, this testing kit is not good, and in some cases, we've even stopped using them because their accuracy levels are very low. So as the teams sit and use various testing kits, they are able to guide what is it that they think is optimal. And I believe it is in this house that we presented the three key considerations that the team looks at on the validated testing kit and make their recommendations. Because we also must buy testing kits that can be used with the equipment that is available in the country. So, Chair, I would say that really there is no issue about us giving direction. The other issue is on the issue of auditing. When the audits are being undertaken, the first thing that we receive from the National Treasury is, can you furnish us with a conditional grant upon which this fund was sent, so that when their auditors go out, they use the audit report, the conditional grant that the ministry gave to the counties, and then audit whether that money was actually used in line with that. But as you was mentioned earlier through my CS and what Honorable Nikal had raised, those are issues that we now need to start thinking about. the roles and the responsibilities and the accountabilities around the flow of funds in the health sector. There was a question from Mheshimiwa Kutuni. He wanted a clarification on the $1.5 billion that was given under supplementary for testing and testing kits. I am confirming that this money in its entirety, because it was GOK funding, was received in June and transferred to KEMSA. As we speak now, I am aware that KEMSA has committed over $320 million, and we are still going to have them commit more because we need testing kits in the country. And I must be very categorical here to say, in every instruction that we have issued, we have told KEMSA to deal with the manufacturer so that we get value for money in the country and we just deal directly and avoid the middlemen. We have done that for the testing kits. And I can tell you, I mean, sometimes the pressure is there, but we remain resolutely committed to ensuring that we get value for money. So, and in my letters, I'm usually very clear that please ensure that you procure this from the manufacturers, but as recommended by this subcommittee. On the issue of about how much KEMSA has received, yes, I want to confirm it does not exceed 2.5 billion shillings. And the reason, and now the other question you ask is, so where does this other money come from that KEMSA has used? KEMSA has its own capital funds. It has capital funds that it uses to buy medicines and other essential commodities which counties can buy from, and literally anyone, even a private hospital, can walk into KEMSA and buy. So what has been bought by KEMSA, outside of what I have talked about, is perhaps what is in contention right now. They have used their capital funds to buy PPEs and what have you, with the hope that they would resell them out to the counties and what have you. So that is where the distinction comes in. Because the ministry's money is World Bank and it has got very stringent rules around it, and the other money is directly controlled by KEMSA. We do not even give a direction. It is between the board of KEMSA and the management that those orders are placed. And that is where the issue would arise from. Thank you.
Fair enough. Fair enough, Madam Piers, for separating the funding that goes to KEMSA. KEMSA is not an independent institution. It says, in any case, the CEO is appointed by the cabinet secretary after the board has done the interview, which means the ministry has a sole responsibility to know how much money they have in the account. So the question is, apart from the almost 2.5, the 1.5 billion, the 300, and then the items, almost the 750, that comes almost to 2.5 billion. Are you in a position to tell us how much money that KEMSA had? And then, two, of almost the 43 billion that is being claimed that KEMSA has used so far, is there any public money that was allocated to KEMSA? Because, like any other parastato, government has to fund it. To what tune? Thank you.
I think, you know, on the matter of KEMSA, again, I will reiterate what the minister indicated. KEMSA has a board, and the board has the responsibility to offer stewardship and oversight over that institution. And whether KEMSA utilizes capital funds and how much capital funds it has, those are documents that are perhaps shared with us in their annual report. But there is a board which oversights the day-to-day activities and actually approves. So if KEMSA went to buy, say, these PPEs using their capital funds, it is actually the business of the board at KEMSA. So really, and on you know, the other details that you have asked, I also do not think that we can talk about a matter that is a subject of investigation right now. Let the investigation be concluded, and we will know, you know, as Kenyans, what actually transpired in KEMSA, if at all there was anything. Thank you very much.
Okay, Madam Chair. Thank you, Chair.
Point of order, Madam Chair. Just a point of clarification from the PS. Could she be insinuating or saying that because the other agency is carrying out their work, that KEMSA cannot appear before us? Would that be the direction she wants to take? Maybe she can confirm.
No. Thank you.
No, I'm just asking for confirmation. Honorable Chair,
I didn't
say she said. I just wanted a clarification.
Thank you, Chair. On that note, we will invite the board here. Our hands are not tied by that. But I wanted to ask a different question, CS. The county and country preparedness. Thank you for waking me. Oh, he was reading something. This is something that is bothering this committee. I don't know how you defined it, how the counties or countries prepared. We need a definition. Number two, there are two areas for dealing with this disease. Number one, where we started is containment. That involves testing capacity, isolations, contact tracing, community health workers, which I have not had in this meeting. And then the other level is mitigation. That is where we are worried very much, because when we talk of preparedness, number of ICUs, number of ventilators, beds. But let me tell you from the public point of view, public health point of view, the United States, which has the advanced technology, including diverting blood to oxygenated unit back to the body, today has over 1,000 deaths a day. So if we take that route with our fragile healthcare system and we say we are prepared, then we are in danger. So I wanted to know, CS, those two levels, containment and mitigation. How do you define it, and how is our funding? How is our funding priorities placed in those levels? Thank you, Chair.
Chair.
Yes, Honorable Cross, but before I forget, before I forget, there's an issue about insurance, the insurance of health workers that we have not managed to answer. So I'll request that we also answer that question.
Chair,
can we have questions go around and then interjections comes in?
Yes.
Chair.
Can we have it go around and then we discuss and finish?
Mine, I just want to add on what Honorable knows, Waziri. Mine is about testing. The cost of testing, Banwasiri, is very expensive to the main Kenyans. And there have been a lot of complaints. Another issue also about testing is the time these results take to come out. Like recently, me, I was to undergo a procedure. It took me 4 days for me to get the results. Tell me now, what about the ordinary Kenyan? And then another thing, Bwana Waziri, you always, every day, you announce these results. We wonder if, are you telling us the real figures or you are telling us figures of last week? Because as much as we know, these results, there are a lot of delays. So we want to know the truth, because if a place like Lancet, we can't get that results in 48 hours. Tell me, where do you get these results of announcing every day or 24 hours? Is that really logic, Bwana Waziri?
Dr. Mugo has been silent for some time.
Thank you, Chair. I think most of the questions which I would have asked has been touched a bit. And I'll just be very brief. I'll just go on to the question of the quarantine centers. I would expect, actually, the medical board and, of course, the ministry to also advise the counties on the distribution of these centers. Because, one, I look at my county, Elgeyo Marakwet, and to tell you the truth, I'm not complaining, because out of the 9 quarantine centers, 7 of them are from one area. And as a matter of fact, in fact, 3 are from one market. And there are so many big areas, actually, vast areas which have not been covered. So I'm wondering, if you have to quarantine in those areas, do they have to travel those 100 kilometers to those 2-3 centers, which are in one place, or 7 in my constituency? Second question, and I think
it has been asked and answered several times, is the question of the masks and also the question of provision of test kits and laboratory agents. Personally, I feel disheartened because if funds have been given out, we would expect the items to come. I know the explanation here is actually probably you are given the last week of this, of June. But it is stated here, actually, it was in the last quarter, which was from April, and this is we are in August. Those are 4 months. And I, to tell you the truth, I have not been satisfied with the answers which have come. Now, on the question of the allowances and the medical cover for the medical personnel, I'm just actually a bit gratified that the CSA is, this is an ongoing program. COVID is not ending today or tomorrow, so it is something that is ongoing. But my question is this, as a ministry, because we realize we really don't know anything about this COVID, we don't know when it will end, have we actually decided, are we as a ministry thinking of continuing that allowance and that cover to assist the counties as you've done in these three, you said it covers only for 3 months, of course you have not dispersed it yet. And finally, which I think is a technical question, and I'm sure you have quite a number of doctors there, 20 million for provision of psychosocial support to the health workers. Let's just pause. What does this entail? Thank you.
Very much. Madam Chair, let me just start with the last one of the testing. And then tie it up a little bit with Honorable Winos. Let me just say this, Madam Chair. At the beginning of this pandemic, when eventually we knew that we had COVID-19 in our country, three things became very important. Number one is to slow, once we realize what it means and what it can do to our health sector, having seen what happened in Italy and the curve that started in Italy, and the fatality that was there in those countries. What we were trying to do initially is to match two things. You match the curve of the growth of the disease with the capacity that you are building in your nation so that your healthcare system is not overrun, which is effectively what happened in Europe. So when we took the quarantine measures that we were taking, as harsh as they seemed at the time, you know, because essentially in March, we had import, you know, or the virus was an imported virus. So what we are trying to do is not that we knew that people are not going to get the virus. Every country in the world is going to get the virus. But the idea was that we must go at a pace, we must contain the situation at a pace that our health sector, you can imagine what would have happened if you had even the kind of people we have today. If we had the 70 odd people or so who are in ICU today, at the time that we did in March or even April, we would not even have been able to keep them. If we had the 1,000 or 2,000 people who are in isolation today, we would not have been able to have them in isolation at the time. So those two things, and that's the reason why contact tracing, and when we started contact tracing, it was so important that we trace and isolate so that the infections do not go into the community at a pace that we cannot be able to manage. You know, this is one of the key things that we are trying to do at the time. You realize, of course, Honorable Morgo, the challenge, when you are trying to do that, you are trying to test, you have no testing capacity. And the establishment of testing capacities is actually not actually on the counties, and not the ones who have been determining the testing facilities that we have. We have depended on most of the existing testing facilities that we have, for example, in KEMRI. So we had a KEMRI in Mombasa, so that is a testing facility. We had a KEMRI in Kericho, so Kericho is a testing facility. We had Kisumu is a testing facility. So we have not really launched new labs as such. What we are trying to do is to utilize the capacity that we have, is to utilize the machines that we have, or relocate some of those machines to other areas so that we can reduce the time it takes to get, and we are establishing them. So far, we have 32 testing facilities in the country, both public and as well as private testing facilities. So in terms of how to contain, in terms of containing the disease, all the measures that we have taken, the curfews, the whatnots, the closure of bars, all these measures are supposed to reduce the level of contacting, the level of contacts between people, the level of the reduction, where if somebody was used to contacting 100 people per day, reduce it to 20 if possible, or even less if you can. And therefore, you slow the growth of the number of people you need to contain or isolate at any one time. So there is a very clear method worked out by very clever people, you know, in the Ministry of Education, as in University of Nairobi, JUCAT, KU. There are some very clever people who are sitting and working on these things. We don't just decide them. Even I don't decide them. They come and advise and tell us on the basis of what we can expect. This is what you can see. Which leads me to the question that the Honorable Owino asked. What do you mean by readiness? Readiness is very calculated on modeling, again on modeling. This is the population of Nairobi. The population, by a certain, they factor in and say, this is the growth of the disease that we can expect in Nairobi. Based on the levels that we can expect, they then go further and say, what is the level, what is the percentage of symptomatic cases that we can expect? And what is the percentage of asymptomatic cases that we can expect? And based on this, they then tell you, you will need so many beds in Nairobi, or you need so many beds in Kisumu. When we say 300 beds in every county, that's a general preparedness status. But if you go to some counties, they've already got 800 beds, and some counties even over 1,000 beds that they can isolate people in based on a worst case scenario. Because we draw a best case scenario, which is perhaps what we are kind of experiencing in some areas where they have got those facilities, but there is nobody there. And a worst case scenario, and we don't know yet whether the worst case scenario or a doomsday scenario is still coming. We don't know. Nobody can tell you that. So the definition of what is ready or what is the level of readiness required is county to county based on some very specific modeling that is calculated by these people in Yumbo, and I'm going to ask him to say something about it. But finally, on the issue of testing, you know, sometimes you see us testing 10,000 people, 8,000 people, then another day 3,000 people. We are still struggling with the acquisition of reagents globally. And I can tell you that one of the shortcomings that we have, and this is something to correct in the future, we live and learn. One of the things that we have learned is that a lot of our systems, you know, because you're using the same machines you are using for testing malaria and so on and so forth, one of the shortcomings is the idea of closed systems, where because you've got a Cobas machine that can only use Roche reagents come from America. Americans are not going to give you Roche reagents or GeneXpert reagents until they satisfy their own market where they are perishing. So on that basis, going forward, it is good for us to think about open systems rather than closed systems. And finally, on the issue of America is a great nation and it has been overwhelmed by these things, and therefore you are likely to be overwhelmed. Why do you think so? Why do you think we cannot teach America what to do? Why is it only America that can teach us what to do? You know, for these ones, we have confidence in ourselves. We don't have to copy. Our environment is different from theirs. Our levels of preparedness are different. Our people are different. They are probably younger. You know, that is why there are so many factors that we are putting in that say that we don't have to go that way. If you take 152 days from when we first received our first COVID case, and you take 152 days in America, same time as we have now, you know, oranges with oranges, or you take 152 days in Italy, And you say, what was the situation in Italy 152 days from the first case to now? You'll find that our cases are very different. And sometimes we fail to understand and not appreciate the amount of work that has gone on in MOH and the amount of diligence that have gone on in terms of our health workers, the work that has gone on in airports, in containment.
Waziri.
Because unfortunately,
clarification,
sometimes
we
beat ourselves too much, Madam Chair.
Waziri, clarification. When you compare Kenya with America, well, of course, Waziri, you know, it is, you see, it is, you need also to raise the number of people who they are being tested in the U.S. and their, you know, their capacity and their technology. Because they could be testing more people per day, whereas we are testing only 3,000 to 6,000 people per day. So I think that one cannot apply here because...
Let me clarify.
Yes, I need clarification.
Because,
yes.
And I'm going to ask Dr. Kuria because he's here to also to speak to it. And also Yumbo. Let me clarify one thing. Once you have got community spread, in fact, WHO has been asking, the value of testing after a certain point is not actually very clear, even though we do it on a day-to-day basis. What I look at, or what we look at the ministry these days, is two things. Number one, we look at the percentage of the community that, out of the percentage that we have tested, what is the fatality rate? I'm sorry, what is the positivity rate? For example, before we stopped the pubs, the positivity rate was always between 15, 17, 18%. Whether you test 100 or whether you test 10,000, positivity rate can be calculated anyway by the ones you get as positive. So the positivity rate during all that period has been above 10% and 17%. So today, for example, when you look at the number of tests that we carried out, and then you look at the number of cases, we have 245 or so, then you see that the positivity rate is below 10%. Now, so that is an important figure to think about and can give you a certain trend. The second thing that you need to look at is actual fatalities. What is our fatality rate? How many people are we losing in the whole scheme of things? Globally, it was about between 4 and 6%. Our fatality rate has been between 1.6 and 1.8%. So just in terms of oranges with oranges, if you just view the logarithms around it and you see what the trends are, you can see clearly, for some odd reason, we don't take credit for this because we don't know. But I can tell you that the initial steps that we took and the mitigating factors that we continue to take are most definitely having an effect.
Chair, I asked this question and I want to say it very slowly because nobody knows where this disease is. But see, as these members of parliament are in the constituency, we are in the community. The reason why I ask this question, you can have those beds in the county, but there is a distance between the beds and the households, which has to be worked on because this virus is within the community. That's why I brought the community health workers. People may be infected in the community, but because nobody have tested them or nobody has used any thermogram to see this raising temperature, some are asymptomatic, they will be spreading the disease within the community. But the beds are in the counties, whatever isolation centers they have. So between the beds and the household, this is why I ask the definition of preparedness. Of course, we can compare oranges and all, but mine is very simple. I don't even need to go into epidemiological analysis. No, these households in Dewa, who may be some living with the virus, community health workers are not empowered to go to each and every household to know whether they are infected or not. The beds are lying somewhere empty. That's what I really need. How do you really, did you define it, and how do you resource those interventions that may be effective? Before even we go global, ourselves. I think you are pointing at him to be answering this. That would be nice.
Especially when they are not symptomatic. There is
CS, use your microphone, please.
I apologize. What I meant, Madam Chair, Honorable Wino's question is very valid and a good one, because it gives me the opportunity, and us, and I'm going to ask Dr. Kuria and Daniel here to respond to some of those things. But the point of the management of this disease, which is case management is what you're now talking about. The point is this, and I'm no doctor, by the way, you know, just so you know, those epidemiological things are strange to me as they are to you. But the point is that what we have learned is two things. Number one is that if you are not symptomatic, and you can be able to be isolated, and you can isolate yourself at home, you are much better and you recover much faster than if you have got than if you are isolated in a facility. That is to begin with. We have trained thousands of community health workers, thousands of them. In fact, we have trained 61,000. We have trained 61,000. Community health workers. I attended myself the training in Nakuru, for example, to watch the training going on. And a lot of it depends on the county, because Mheshimiwa, our role was to train trainers. Once we train the trainers, then they continue with the training at the county levels. Again, coming back to, some counties have done a fantastic job, some counties have not. Now, so there could be, you are right, there could be a lot of people who are actually positive. They have no symptoms of any kind and they have no reason to go to a testing facility. But there is no possibility of us walking house to house going to test people. A, it's very expensive, which we can't really do. And two, we really wonder whether it is even useful in the first place. So let me ask Dr. Imbwa to Daniel Imbwa to speak, and then ask Dr. Kuria to talk about your last issue.
Why don't you give it to Dr. Kuria?
Honorable members,
just
kindly,
madam. Yes, just madam,
just
so that
the chair, so that we have order.
Madam Chair, yes, so that Dr. Kuria will clarify. Waziri, you've just said that you are very clever people in the ministry. Before you make a decision, you are very highly qualified people in the university. But the same people told us that by August or maybe July, we will be having 10,000 per day. And these are people who are highly qualified. Well, did they mislead the ministry?
No.
So, Dr. Kuria.
Hold on. That's not a fair one for Kuria. Madam Chair, if you allow, let me respond to this one. They told us, they have given us very specific figures about what would happen if you do nothing. They have told us very clearly, you do nothing. They even predicted, if you do nothing, if you don't have any quarantine, if you don't have any stoppage of airports, if you don't have any people, you're stopping bars and you're stopping all these things, you will have 26,000 dead Kenyans at the end of a year. The reason why you have got 400 is because of what we did. Thank you.
Chair, through you, Chair.
Is it on the same matter, or do we allow
the
Dr. We allow Daniel Lubia to respond?
So that when we leave there, we leave it completely. I wanted a clarification from Waziri or the PS on the issue of KEMRI. We have also National Influenza Lab and National Public Health Laboratories. What have you done, or how much funds have you given to those institutions to also help this on fight against this COVID thing, on testing? Because I went to a place like KEMRI recently and they didn't have test kits.
Okay, I think we'll still go. Let's start with Daniel Lumia.
Yes, Honorable Chair, through my head of delegation, the concerns raised by Honorable Owino and Honorable Murgo and Honorable Koros about containment and mitigating factors about the fight against COVID-19 within the counties. I must admit, yes, about the identification of quarantine sites, we work together with the county governments. As you will agree with me, some of them gave us lists that we disputed because some facilities were very close to each other. And having been pointed out by honorable members, we shall go, send our team to assess particular counties, and we shall rearrange these facilities. As the CS indicated, some of the quarantine centers are still vacant. They are not being used. So moving one quarantine site to another area will not be a big problem. So that we shall take, and I shall be able to give the realignment through the CS shortly. Number two is about the containment measures. that we as council have put in place. One, we still controlling entry through the Namaga and Taveta and Busia borders. We still not allowing people who are moving in from certain countries without the certificates besides the national airports. But the other issue that I would like to talk about is the use of the health workers in the community level. Phase two of our teams, which is going beginning September 10th, is going to take this into consideration. And I'm sure through the CS, we shall update you on what findings we have found in specific counties about the use of community health workers in support of the fight against COVID-19. I submit.
Dr. Kuria.
Thank you, Chair, Honorable Members. I think to answer Honorable Owino, yes, how are we in terms of preparedness? And I do recall when you got our first case in March, and as the CS rightly says, this country was not ready for this pandemic. We had no quarantine facilities, no isolation facilities, and testing was limited to actually external sourcing of a laboratory in South Africa. But over time, the increase in laboratory capacities is evidence enough that the country is making progress in terms of preparedness. We have no quarantine facilities, and the report tabled in this committee today is evidence again that the country is making progress in terms of preparedness. Quarantine initially, of course, was only based around Nairobi, as we are accepting arrivals from abroad. But today, the committee again has been informed of quarantine and isolation facilities available throughout the 47 counties. Our bed capacity has increased to 11,000. Now, the concern here, of course, is the readiness in counties and as compared to Nairobi, and we have told about 23% of readiness in Nairobi. But again, we must also look at the face of how the containment measures have been applied in this country. And I do recall when the restrictions of movements were placed, and this was done, again, to give counties and the sub-counties time to make preparedness plans for them, for the counties and sub-counties. There are circulars, of course, issued from the Ministry of Health to the counties to establish emergency response committees at the county sub-county levels. And today, as we speak, every sub-county has an emergency response committee that we are able to communicate from the Public Health Emergency Operations Center that takes care of response efforts at both at the county and the sub-county level. We all know that, of course, in the pandemic is evolving, and the containment measures that were placed by the country, by the government, having quarantine and restriction of movement in Nairobi has taken the pandemic in this country through several phases. And several counties, of course, are different phases of this pandemic. There's a phase zero where we were when we did not have any case in this country. Went through phase one, where we got at least one case, one sporadic case. And then you get cases in clusters. And you could say, for example, we only got a case in Samburu and Pokot about 2 weeks ago. Yet in Nairobi, we're already at phase three, phase four, we have widespread community transmission. The response efforts will be different in all those phases of the epidemic. So the response in Samburu will be the same as the response in Nairobi. In Samburu, the main efforts will be at identifying the index case, trace the contact aggressively so that you contain the infection without before it spread further in Samburu. In Nairobi, one would wonder, and CDC, which is going to advise you, the value of contact tracing in Nairobi now may be valueless. It's a cost resource intensive, and may not yield much in terms of containment. So then, for Nairobi, then the measures will be geared towards identifying the vulnerable groups and protecting them against mortalities, as opposed to what would happen in a place like Samburu. So different countries were given 30-day period to prepare their isolation quarantine facilities. The report, of course, has told us more about their preparedness. And the HR needs are still identified as a gap, as per the report table today. And as I said, as they go into phase two, they need to address these HR issues, psychosocial issues, and capacity building further even for the community health workers. Because as we go more into the home-based care protocols that are going to be relied more in managing these cases, then we need more of these home-based care, community health care workers to address these home-based care requirements. So the country, yes, is ready as per report, but there are gaps, of course, and it is still work in progress as HR needs, and even for some, developing more isolation facilities. I submit.
Thank you. And now that we have the CEOs, I would like to give them an opportunity. We can start with MTRH. We have KNH. We have KEMRI, KU. I think it's good you also give your comment at this point.
Yeah.
I want to start with MTRH.
Chair, there is one question actually which seems not to be answered. I said, what are the plans of the Ministry of Health in terms of the insurance and also the allowances of the medical staff going forward?
I have actually written the issues that have not been responded to. Once the CEO's comment will come, the issue of insurance, the issues of even HR needs, will come back so that now we'll be coming to summarize with the PS and the CS.
Your kind permission, my understanding is that the CEOs are just commenting on general matters. Why don't they answer the questions that have been posed and not answered? Like this one I asked. Were these monies by KEMSA paid? Or they stopped the payments once they realized that there were issues? Was that answered?
That's what I said. All those pending answers. I think
It would be better that the answer, what has been posed and not answered. Other than just the CEOs just commenting generally on...
That's okay. PS?
Thank you, Chair. On the issue of payments to KEMSA or by KEMSA, as I said, there are two sources of funding that have been directed to KEMSA. The World Bank Fund, and anything procured under World Bank is not paid until the process is complete, everything is accepted, which is actually in line with the Public Procurement Act. And that money does not even sit in KEMSA. It is only disbursed to KEMSA when the process is complete. So all the documents that KEMSA has submitted and have been, you know, cleared by the ministry and, more importantly, cleared by the World Bank have been paid. And to date, everything that has come has been paid. So we are still waiting for them to submit for the outstanding payments because we have not cleared everything that was ordered through them. On the monies of the government, the 300 million for the masks, that money is being held by KEMSA, and KEMSA will pay once the work has been completed and delivered. Then the money will be disbursed because it is there. On the matter of the 1.5 billion for the testing kits, also that the money was moved to KEMSA so that we are not caught up with lack of funds in the beginning of this financial year. So we are ordering to KEMSA, and as soon as, again, the suppliers who have been given the work or the manufacturers who have been, awarded, of course, following the due procurement processes, have delivered, the money is then paid to the suppliers through KEMSA. But as I said earlier, that is as far as the money from the Ministry of Health is concerned. There is money that KEMSA has used from its own capital funds. On that, I may not be able to comment because that is within the jurisdiction of their board, and even what they determined to buy is not a direction that came from the Ministry of Health. So I cannot comment on any procurement that KEMSA undertook using their capital funds.
Thank you. Thank you. Through the chair, you know the PS, Madam Susan Muchache, is accounting officer. She's done very well, a bit, but there's one bit that she is very vague. Talked about 1.5, the 300 million, but the initial payment by KEMSA, that which was paid out, would you kindly, through the chair, maybe give us the figures? To avoid a situation, maybe let me save your back. Yes. To avoid a situation where people might, and mark my words, might be speculating that 53 billion is lost, that 23 billion is lost. Maybe you could be kind enough to give us the figures, because we shall be getting it, as the Englishman would say, from the horse's mouth.
Chair and honorable members, as we made the presentation on the monies in the ministry received for COVID, we were very clear to say we have received in total 23,448,500,000. And Chair, we have taken the committee through line by line on how this money has been spent and, in fact, disbursed, because the spending will now be determined at the point at where the money has reached. Have the counties spent? That would be another story. But have the counties received their money? Yes, they have. Did the National Referral Hospitals receive their money? Yes, they did. Did KMTC get its money? Yes, they did. Now, when you come down, we have also summarized for you on page 9 to page 11. Now, a brief overview of how these funds were used. And the ones that relate to KEMSA only fall under that on page 9, as I said earlier, the 1 billion shillings. Part of this 1 billion was used for buying PPEs, testing kits, reagents, and things like that. And to date, we have not received all the documents related to those procurements at the Ministry to Facilitate.